Pleased to meet you, fella. It's been about a year since we last had a chat.
Yeah.
And boy, you've been busy, haven't you?
Yes, indeed.
Lots of things going on. We will get to that slightly later. I interviewed you a year ago, and I just wanted to go over some of those things in the interview, but I just want an update as well. What I'm going around the country talking to the UK's top chefs about is what inspired you to become a chef? Where did it begin for you?
Well, basically, I would say when I was, you know, growing up, very young, probably about 8, 9, when I was with a mother in the kitchen and my twin brother as well, who's a chef as well, as many people know, and just, you know, messing around, playing in the kitchen there. So I progressed really from there and helping out, making simple cakes and biscuits, toffee, caramels, all those kind of things. You know, little kids have sweet tooth, so it all went from there. And we lived in Norfolk, so we grew a lot of our own vegetables in the garden, and we had fruit trees and berry bushes. You know, grew raspberries and blackcurrants and blackberries, rhubarb, lots of vegetables. So we even had our own little veg patch each, so we could grow our own vegetables as well, and then we used to pick them and then cook them. And so it all stemmed from there. And then, probably from about the age of 12, we were then starting to cook, the whole meal. And then obviously, by the age of 13, it's I had, that idea of becoming a chef.
That sounds really, it sounds like you had a real connection with ingredients from an early age.
Yeah, no, definitely. And it was, it was great. Being able to go to the garden, pick the vegetables, see it grow, understand how
phones everywhere going off.
understand how
it's live.
I have to get this actually. Sorry. Hello.
Have this fantastic connection with nature.
Yeah.
How common do you think that is in your generation to have had that kind of connection with that?
I think it's very important to understand ingredients, to understand produce, to have the respect for it. I think now in this country, we are striving, for getting the best of everything, particularly obviously with ingredients. And I think, before, I would say we lacked the knowledge and the experience of obtaining and growing. But now I'd say, definitely in terms of the fields of protein, so meat and fish, we're very much at the top of the game. I think we still don't contend with other parts of Europe to the varieties and obviously to the seasonality. Obviously, because of the tendency of having just rain in this country doesn't particularly help. But the progress is over the last few years has been significant. So I think the next few years, I think in terms of the product, the produce of the vegetables, it's going to grow. It's always been one thing that I've always slightly been annoyed with, of not being able to get the best of a particular vegetable or the variety as much as our colleagues in other parts of Europe. But they have the climate, and in terms of the consistency of getting that ingredient, it's already established. But we're definitely coming along for sure.
If you went into a college today, because there's going to be a lot of young chefs watching this on their first day of their first year, what advice would you give them?
I think in terms of students today, I think the skill level and the enthusiasm is definitely a lot higher from when I was at college. That's for sure. In terms of the equipment that they get to use is vastly improved. So I think, there's a lot more that the students are learning today, and it's not just about putting a piece of fish in a pan. It's actually understanding the the scientific approach of why we're putting that fish in the pan, what actually happens to it, how does it cook, what happens to the protein. So there's all that information now you know, at the click of a button, you go on, you know, you go on the web and it's there for you. It's not just a question of just reading it now. So I think in terms of, you know, the students today going to college, there is, you know, a much broader wealth of information for them to use. So I think overall the students are much more benefiting from not just what they're taught, but also, you know, what's all around them in terms of the chefs, in terms of books, in terms of web, everything. So I think in terms of, you know, them studying, I think the study part is for me the most important as opposed to practical. The practical side of it, you know, is obviously about knife skills, and I think overall time, knife skills sharpen up all the time. But it's the reading and the knowledge that is far more valuable.
Looking back on your own career as a chef, how old or what period in your career did you find that you clicked into place with food, i.e. the muscle memory was there, the knife skills were intuitive, you knew subconsciously when to open the oven, you could tell by just running a fork through carrots how they were cooked and stuff like that. When did you begin, when did all that come together for you?
Probably 21, 22, I'm gonna think. I obviously left, you know, I went to school, left school at 16, then went to college for 2 years. And then after sort of the first couple of jobs, you know, my second job was with David Cavalier and I was still, you know, a commie. And then by the time I was 20, I was then with Pierre Koffmans. So sort of probably the first few months with him, you know, was very difficult. And I was on the larder, thankfully. Kitchen full of French-speaking chefs, which didn't particularly help, and you know, very stubborn. Didn't want you to learn anything either. So it was kind of, you know, you were on your own, and you had to kind of, you know, just go with the flow. And then after that, he then put me on the fish section, and you know, I hadn't filleted fish since I was at college, and obviously, you know, the fish prep that I did at college was vastly different to what I was going to be doing in a 2-3 star. You know, restaurant. So I kind of had, you know, a quick sort of road crash test with Mr. Coffin, because, you know, he definitely sort of helped over the first, you know, few weeks, and then just left me to it. So I had to get up to speed very quickly. So I'd say, you know, by the time I left there, you know, which was, I was then 21 and a half, two.
That was
I was then, you know, pretty accomplished.
In the zone.
Yeah, chef.
But it is painful to that point.
Yeah, it is, because, you know, with all chefs you make mistakes. And I'm afraid to say that all chefs, you know, make mistakes. You know, we all still make mistakes. You know, it's all about the learning. And you don't make mistakes. So you don't learn if you don't make mistakes. So you know, it's a process, but obviously, you know, at the beginning, it's more the sort of simplistic ones, you know, that you shouldn't be repeating. So, i.e., you know, cutting up, you know, salmon, you know, wrongly, or preparing meat and boning it out, you know, incorrectly, or overcooking a piece of meat. It's all those types of things that you hope, you know, once, twice, you may make that mistake, and then after that, that's it, because then you've understood. So, you know, I think at the beginning, the sort of the knife skills and everything are, for a young lad, you know, the most important thing to learn, you know, quickly. And then the rest, the judging of dishes, of cooking, and obviously things coming together, you know, is more an experience, which will come over time.
Very good, very good. If I gave you £500, where would you go in the UK to dine today?
I think I'd go out of London because I don't do it enough.
No, true. So, I am trying to get you north.
Yeah. So no, I would either go to, you know, Sapains or Simon Rogan for sure, because I haven't, you know, I haven't been, and you know, I'd love to go.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Very unique. Very unique. If I gave you £5,000 for anywhere in the world.
£5,000. I would probably, I think with £5,000 you can do more than one trip. So
okay, you're gonna do a couple.
I would probably go to Paris, go to L'Estrance in Paris. Then I would go back to Noma. I would go to Arzak. And then maybe finish off with Sophie Pig.
Fantastic. I'll be putting all the website URLs up for this. You're obviously involved with our project training final. How important is it for guys in your position to reach down to bring up the standards of those who are coming behind you? Do you see that?
Yeah, I think it's very important for, you know, us elder chefs to look at obviously the youth of today and to see how they're coping, what their requirements are, you know, where they want to go, you know, make sure they, you know, get on the right path to where, you know, they want to go, you know, be it as an individual or, you know, in a in a direction of possibly working in a bigger field of, you know, of catering, because, you know, there are many directions that you can go now. It's not just about, you know, being a chef behind a stove. You can, you know, you can go and do so many different, you know, things now. Mm-hmm. The spectrum of that is much bigger. So I think, you know, the most, you know, important tool I think to give people is, you know, or to students, is to realise for them what they want to do, because I think, you know, a lot of youngsters, you know, they kind of have a dream and they kind of have, you know, a hope of doing something, but it's trying to make that a goal and, you know, putting it into a perspective of where they can see the benefits of obviously of where they want to go, but also, you know, the correct way of doing it.
And
setting out for them, which I do, you know, with, you know, with a lot of my chefs, is just, you know, try and get them to understand, right, you know, if you want to be a head chef, then this is what you've got to do, this is where you've got to do, this is where you've got to go, and this is the experience that you need to get. Because, you know, I think a lot of chefs, you know, don't have, I'd say, the necessary sort of either maturity or understanding of how to get, you know, from A to B.
Very, very. And are you aware that, like, you know how young chefs or chefs, you know, quite below the star level, feel when they connect with you, how inspired they are? Do you get that? Or your peer set? Do you think your peer set get that?
No, I do, but it's I think everyone, you know, even for me, when I remember where, you know, I wanted to go and how I was going to get there, you know, I had my goals and I had, you know, the ways of getting there. Apart from
you haven't being, forgotten, have you?
No, and apart from being, you know, bloody determined and stubborn, which you have to be. But it's just, you know, realizing, you know, that if you have a dream or you have goals, that they can, you know, they can be achieved. Mm. And it's just believing in yourself and making sure that you don't slip back or you don't, you know, deviate off the path that you want to take.
So you're just not a chef, you're a businessman.
Mm.
There's a huge lesson there. There are in your peer set, there are people who have branched out like you.
Mm.
I think if chefs just think if they're good cooks, they're going to make it. Would you say that's true, or do you think they need to have a bit of savvy as well?
No, I think you've got to have a bit of savvy. I mean, you know, I've been through, you know, I've been through the run of the mill, and I had obviously a bit of a, you know, shit time in 2008. But you know, you understand reasons why, and you know, in terms of, you know, getting back on your feet and sort of, you know, brushing yourself down and getting on with it. It's kind of proves, you know, that I'm a bit of a
resilient
chap. But it's like, you know, the whole process of understanding, you know, your business and your customers is super, super important.
You do that very well.
And I think, you know, it's looking at obviously, you know, your target market of what you are trying to be, what you're trying to do, connecting, making sure that, you know, you connect with your people and obviously, you know, your peers as well, because I think it's, you know, it's very important, I think, to keep, you know, your head sort of below water, you know, to a degree, and not become a bit of a sort of egotistical, you know, kind of chef, which some are. And I think, you know, to be able to connect with, you know, chefs alike, you know, is super important. But in terms of a, you know, a business side, you know, where so with Tom's Kitchen, where, you know, it's obviously sort of a different cooking to what I do at the other restaurant, you know, which I enjoy just as much, but this is the, sort of the restaurant that, you know, is financially more viable because of, you know,
I think you've set a trend.
the food,
yes.
You know, the profit margin on the food in terms of, and the costs of staffing costs, running costs are a lot less as well. So it's, you know, it's a model that, you know, we're, you know, finally tuning. You know, we're going to be doing, you know, a few more of them, but it's just like trying to really understand, you know, the models in terms of, you know, when I do a new menu, for instance, it takes me at least, I change the menu 3 times a year, so, but it takes me at least 4 months to do a whole menu, because, you know, I do every new single dish that I do, obviously I test it first, so I cook it with the guys probably, you know, 3-4 times until we get it right, so it comes on as a special, we get it right. Then once it's right, then I weigh and measure every ingredient, then it's costed, then you know, then I do a picture of it, and then we do, that then goes into a staff manual as well. So it's that whole process that takes, you know, a phenomenal amount of time. But the end result, you know, your staff are well trained, you've got, you know, the exact costing, so I, you know, I go down to everything that's in that dish, so, you know, the weight, the salt, the pepper, seasonings, spices, everything, you know, so it's looking at all of that, and then in terms of, you know, understanding, you know, the cost of the chefs, you know, how much effort goes into each dish, all of that is accounted for, so, you know, it's understanding all those, you know, and trying to, you know, squeeze the margins as much as you can as well. It closed last weekend, so it is closed now, so it will be reopening at some point in October, maybe, we'll see.
What's your plan for the cooking style and the menu?
So basically the whole interior is being gutted and, you know, we're completely renovating it, so sort of the tablecloths are all going. Glasses are changing, silverware's going, plates changing, there'll be no more white plates, they're all going. So yes, it's radically changing, uniforms, you know, are all changing, everything. So it's going away from being, I'd say, the stark and serious, to being more open, more fun, more relaxed, more informal, and just making it more sort of accessible,
oh, yeah.
More enjoyable,
more emotional, yeah.
All of those. So in terms of, you know, the interior, for instance, we're just making it quite organic. So, you know, there's a lot of materials we're using, a lot of like wood, we're using a lot of concrete, so sort of polished and unpolished concrete. Then there's some sort of raw sort of rusted iron as well, which we're using, so you know, it'll be very, very different in terms
very
of
organic.
All the plates, they're all being made, so I've got about 4 or 5, you know, odd sort of potters that are making me different plates. So they were, no one will know where they're coming from, so I'm keeping that
absolutely
a big secret.
So your cooking style, can we still expect superb combinations?
Yes,
like
that's,
lemon and goat's cheese emulsion? And
yeah, that's all, you know, going to be pretty much the same, but I mean, I'm going to be looking at different dishes and everything else as well. And the style of the menu will be different as well. So no, I'm really looking forward to it. I mean, there's going to be some simple dishes on there as well. You know, like, I don't know, suckling pig for two or whatever, sort of, you know, some simple dishes. And then, you know, in terms of the menu, it'll be simple in the sense of there'll be like fish, so there'll be vegetables, fish, and meat. So we'll have three sections, and then maybe four in each section. And then you can either have them, you know, as a starter or as a main course. So there is that flexibility, and in that menu as well, you can make your own tasting menu as well. So there'll be, in that menu, there'll be like three different prices. So you can then kind of make your own menu up.
Fantastic.
Have your own starters. If you just want to have starters, have starters. If you want to have just a main course, you can have one main course. So it's not like it's set. And in that, I think it's just offering, you know, sort of customers a bit more, you know, flexibility.
Fantastic. Well, that sounds really exciting, Tom. Mm. And I can't wait for October to roll on, really. I think that's a really fantastic update on your ethos. Lots of chefs from different genres will be watching this. Thanks very much for your time.
Pleasure.
Fantastic.
Thank you. Lovely.